Hi everyone, welcome to this tutorial on Go interfaces. Thank you for tuning in. This is the second part of what is going to end up being a four-part series covering Golang interfaces. If you're completely new to the concept of interfaces in Go, I strongly recommend that you watch the first video, part one of this series. Golang interfaces operate slightly different than the interfaces in some other programming languages, and that first tutorial will provide you with a foundational understanding as well as some key concepts like abstract and concrete types. This video will cover slightly more advanced topics and assumes that you already know the basics. As the agenda states here, in this tutorial I'll discuss type assertions, empty interfaces, and the type switch statement, and then I'll finish up discussing what you can expect in the next video of this series. So let's get started. In the last video, I provided an example of a Golang interface by declaring this shape interface. I then showed that you could create a struct like this one of type rectangle with various properties and methods, two of which are defined in the shape interface, meaning that it satisfies that interface. You can then create a function that accepts a shape interface like this calculate function. Then within our main method, we created an instance of the rectangle and showed that you can pass that rectangle instance into the calculate function as a parameter of type shape and call the interface methods. At the end, I posed the question, if we wanted to call the rectangle method getSides from within the calculate function, how would we do that? And just to make sure you guys are following me, this is what I'm saying. If we change the calculate function to accept a rectangle type instead, there's no question that Go would allow us to call all three of these methods from within the calculate function, right? At that point, it's just the standard parameter. But our function accepts a shape interface, which doesn't define a getSides function. So calling something like s.getSides is not allowed. That's where type assertion comes in. Type assertion lets us extract the value of the underlying type that gets passed in, which is a rectangle, then call the methods on that returned value. The reason we're able to do this is because when we pass in an instance as an interface parameter, that instance still has an underlying type and value. In our case, the type is rectangle, and the value is the value or values associated with the instance of that struct that was passed in. We can then call the methods on that instance value that gets returned. But in order to do this, we have to tell the program or make a type assertion about the underlying type of that interface. And like I said, once we do that, we're able to extract that value, store it in a variable, and then we can call the methods on that variable because now that variable has a type and value equal to the underlying type and value of that interface. If that sounds confusing, don't worry about it. I'm going to hop over to the code and I'll illustrate this further. All right. So again, this is the code that we put together in the previous video, part one of this series covering interfaces. If this code looks confusing or foreign to you, please do go check out that video. Up top here, we have defined our interfaces, we have our functions here, and then in the main method, we create an instance of the rectangle and make a call to that calculate function where we pass in that instance. Before I show you how to do a type assertion, I just kind of want to illustrate what I mean when I say these interfaces have an underlying type and value. So for this parameter that gets passed in, I can use interpolation along with these template strings, %t and %v, to print out the type and value of the underlying struct within this interface. And when I print that out, you can see here at the right that it says my type is main.rectangle because it's from the main package. And then it's got my type and then the values of each one of those fields within that struct. So we can see that that passed in parameter has an underlying type and value. It's in there somewhere. We just need to use type assertion to extract it out. And when you do that, you're extracting it out into a new variable. This is what it would look like. line 43 is where I've performed the type assertion. And the syntax for this is to use the variable that you are making an assertion about, followed by a period. And then in parentheses, you place the type that you are saying is the underlying value of this interface. And we do that because at this point, the Go program doesn't see this parameter as a rectangle. It sees it as a shape interface. Now that the underlying value has been extracted into this new variable called rect, we can call all of the methods of a rectangle just by, you know, simply putting them in this print line function and having them printed to the console. So that's the first way you can use type assertion, which is to make an assertion about the underlying type of the passed in interface. The other way you can use type assertion is to assert about an interface. You can assert that the variable implements another type of interface. It's possible for a variable or a type to implement two different interfaces. And in that case, what gets returned is a variable still having the underlying type and value, but the program now recognizes it as an interface, the same interface that you asserted was in that original variable. For example, let's say that the rectangle struct also implemented a second interface called polygon, which declares the getSides function. Now within this calculate function, we can assert that the passed in parameter implements the polygon interface as well. Aside from that, we don't need to change anything else in our code. So you can kind of see this as saying, you know, we're making the claim that this parameter implements this interface, or in the case of a, you know, actual type or struct that we're making an assertion on, we're making the claim that this is the underlying type. And when we run the program and print out the results, we see that the results are the exact same as the previous type assertion. Now, one thing to be aware of with type assertions is that it is completely possible to make the wrong type of assertion. We know that we're passing in a rectangle into this calculate function. But if I was to say, well, I want to make the claim that this passed in parameter is of type circle, what happens is that your Go program will panic. And if you're not familiar with what a panic is just a runtime error in Go. It's something you always want to avoid. It basically means your program has hit an error and it's shutting down. It's no longer going to execute anything. So while we can certainly make type assertions in the way that I've done it so far, best practice is to do it slightly different. Because we don't want to put our program in a state that it can't recover from. The way that we do this is really simple. Instead of returning one variable that would hold our value, we're going to return two variables. So we just add a second one here. The variable is called OK. And we're going to include this type assertion. We're going to stick all of this into an if statement. And if you haven't seen this type of syntax around an if statement, it's just a way for us to declare a variable and check the value of a variable all in one statement. So we're declaring a variable rect, which of course is going to hold the value, and we're declaring a variable OK, which is of type Boolean. And the value of OK is going to be true or false depending on whether or not we have made an assertion about the correct type contained within that value. And the value of OK is going to be true or false depending on whether or not we have made a correct assertion about the underlying type of that variable. So if we're correct, obviously it's going to be true. If we're wrong, then it's going to be set to false. And so this statement then checks the value of OK. So we're saying, you know, we would declare these variables, and if OK is true, then go ahead and execute the following code. And what we've done now is kind of implemented this safeguard and protected ourselves against a panic in a circumstance, you know, where we're asserting the wrong type, because we're saying, let's check and verify that we've asserted the correct thing before we try to execute any other code. Now let's move on to discussing the empty interface. When I first started learning Golang, there was a point at which I understood interfaces. I knew how to use them. I knew how to implement them. And then I came across this thing here, empty interface, and was just very confused. But I want to let you guys know that the empty interface is a very simple concept, and it's really nothing special about it. I really think that it's just the syntax and the way that it looks that causes some confusion among new Go developers. But I promise if you understand everything I've explained so far, you're going to understand this very quickly. And just to kind of explain this, let's look at the interface that we've already covered. The shape interface. We discussed the syntax for declaring this interface and what it means to actually satisfy the interface. For a type to satisfy it, it needs to implement both of these methods. And it's okay if the type has more than just these two methods, but at the very least, it must have an area and perimeter method that returns a float 64. What if we define the interface like this instead? Well, now, of course, a type only needs to implement the area method to satisfy that requirement. What about now? Well, now the type can have zero or more methods because there are no methods defined in this interface. And every type in Go has zero or more methods. And that's all an empty interface is. It's just a placeholder. It's a placeholder that can stand in for any and every type in Go because all types implement zero or more methods. I can illustrate this further in our code. If we go back to the code here, what we see is that we can actually change the parameter type of this calculate function to an empty interface, and everything still works fine. It still has an underlying type and an underlying value. And we can even declare a variable of type empty interface at the top here. And what that means is that any value can be stored within that variable. I'll illustrate that down here. I can store a string, an integer, a boolean into this variable I. It doesn't matter because they all satisfy that empty interface. One of the places you'll sometimes see that empty interface syntax is when you see a map of type string to empty interface. And what that means is that the individual values of the map can be any value. If you've worked with the JSON marshaling and unmarshaling functions, sometimes you'll see that we unmarshal JSON objects into a map of string interface. And that's because JSON objects can contain various types. So a map of string interface will hold whatever value and type that JSON object has in it. The last thing I'll discuss in this video is type switch statements. Type switch statements are similar to switch case statements in the sense that they are an alternative to creating or writing multiple else-if statements within your code. In the examples that I've covered today, we already know the underlying type and value of the interface being passed in. But in real-world examples, you often don't know what the underlying type and value is. Often, you're working with someone else's code, or you don't know what the parameter is that's going to be passed into your function. In this situation, there may be specific lines of code that you only want to be executed depending on the underlying type of that variable, which, as I said, you may not know. So if we didn't know the underlying type of this parameter s, we could write a collection of if and else if statements to check that underlying type and then execute code accordingly. And we can add an else statement at the end here as kind of a default case to execute this line of code if none of the other statements are run. So all of this would be pretty easy to follow and understand. And a type switch statement is just an alternative to that. In order to write a type switch statement, you just use the keyword switch followed by the variable that we want the returned value to be stored in. And then we can create cases that will run code depending on whether or not the type defined in the case matches the underlying type of the variable stored in X. And the default case at the end is kind of like that last else statement. If all else fails, then we're going to run this default case. That does it for this second video covering Golang interfaces. In this tutorial, we've discussed type assertions, empty interfaces, and type switch statements. If you guys have any questions or feedback, please let me know in the comments. In the next video, we'll be taking it a step further and discussing Golang reflection. Please subscribe if you guys would like to see more videos like this. Subscribing really does help. It truly, truly is appreciated. Otherwise, I'll see you guys in the next video on esoteric tech. Thanks for watching.